turn to Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3, I will begin reading in verse 13. But before I read, remember, Nebuchadnezzar has set up a golden image and demanded that his golden image be served and worshipped. And he basically told all the people of Babylon, the people who were there, gathered there at Babylon, when you hear the music, strike up, then you bow down and worship my God. Now this is not my message this morning, but you remember in the book of the Revelation, when it talks about the beast that was and is not and yet is. And that beast is said to be connected with what? Mystery Babylon.
Yes, sir.
Does not religion today tell men and women, as a general practice, when you hear the music strike up, you come forward and you bow to our God? That's Babylon.
Yes, sir.
That's Babylon. Now, I will preach that, not that message, but I'll mention that on the radio, God willing, maybe in January, maybe it's March, I forget. But when it does, if the proverbial stuff hits the fan, that's going on the tape, ain't it? If it does, then be ready. Because that's what it is. It's Babylon. But remember, Nebuchadnezzar has had this image erected, and he demands, with the threat of death, you bow down and worship my God. Now Nebuchadnezzar is told that there are three Jewish boys who haven't bowed down to his image. Now he had set these three Jewish boys up over the province of Babylon.
Yes, sir.
But this is what it reads in verse 13. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury. Don't forget that. Don't forget that. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now, if ye be ready, this is what all religion wants this. I heard the preacher say, I forget who it was, I believe it was Cunningham say this. Everybody wants a second chance.
Yeah, there you go.
Everybody thinks that salvation's about second chances. Well, Nebuchadnezzar was giving them a second chance.
Yeah, there you go.
Now, if ye be ready, that at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made. Well, but if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is that God? Here's one of his. Here, now, everything he said thus far has been error.
Yeah.
But now he begins to tread on ground he should not tread on.
There you go.
And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? I will say this, and I hope you understand what I mean when I said he crossed the line here.
Oh, yeah. That's exactly right.
God suffers lots of things. He is long-suffering, but there comes a time when men and women cross the line. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Now I'll read just the first part of the next verse. Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his visage was changed. changed. He liked these three boys.
Yep.
He had set them up over province. He had gave them position in his kingdom, but now they've crossed the line. Now they've crossed the line. Now, verses 16 through 18, this is going to be some deep stuff, is the response of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Ain't that deep? That's deep, right? But verses 16 through 18 is the response of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to Nebuchadnezzar's self-centered, government-sponsored madness. Now listen to me.
Yeah.
I want to give you something this morning. Nothing, no kind of worship ever sponsored by any human government has ever been God-honoring. Never. Never. Now listen to me. I know the Constitution gives us the freedom of religion. And I am grateful for such a thing. But let me tell you this. That very same constitutional right makes some men and women think that they have the right to worship God as they want to worship God. And God does not give us that right.
Exactly.
God says you worship me and my son, or you don't worship me at all.
Amen.
That is God's constitution. That is God's word. So, this self-centered, government-sponsored religious madness is responded to by Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But this text, nor the Bible as a whole, neither are about men. Rebellious or faithful. Nebuchadnezzar was an idolatrous ruler.
Yes, sir.
His religious madness and his pride, God Almighty turned on him. Look at the next chapter.
Yes, sir.
It took at least a year before this happened, but God turned it on him. And God brought this proud rebel down.
Yes, he did.
But this book is not about Nebuchadnezzar. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were faithful Jewish believers. They were looking for the consolation of Israel, Joe.
Yes, sir.
And God advanced them under Nebuchadnezzar. Go back and read chapter 3 and verse 30. You'll see, after all this is over, he advances them. But I want you to think about this. Had he not advanced them in the first place, they wouldn't have been in his spot.
There you go.
But he advanced them in the first place, and that put them in the tight spot.
Yeah.
Okay. We often think when things go well or smooth, whoa, what a blessing from God.
Yeah.
It may be a test from God.
Yeah. You're right. Yeah. Yes, sir.
You understand? Boy, God gave me this. Yeah, he may have given you this to see which will be first and which will be second or last in your life. This book is not about men and women. It includes the subject of men and women. This book, one lesson is sure from the preponderant testimony of Scripture. One lesson is sure. This book is about God Almighty.
Amen.
That's what this book's about.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there are two things that I can give you from this text. There's another lesson here that's sure from the preponderant testimony of both Scripture and experience. There are two things that are not the end or the goal of this life. It's not about God bringing down proud rebels. Because not every proud rebel is brought down in this life.
Right.
As a matter of fact, the greatest majority of proud rebels, God will leave as proud rebels to die in their sin.
You're right.
When God brought down Nebuchadnezzar, it didn't change all of Babylon, did it?
No.
It did not become a state that worshiped God, did it? Not only that, here's another lesson. another part of it. Not every believer will find advancement in this world in lieu of their fidelity to God. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were placed over more province once this happened. Yes, they were. But do not take that God owes you anything in lieu of your fidelity to Him. Your fidelity to Him is required.
Yes, sir.
No matter whether you find advancement or death.
That's right.
That's my title this morning, Fidelity to God.
Yes, sir.
But the word simply means faithful. That's fidelity. Faithful, devoted, loyal. And I'm here to say this morning, sadly, even amongst professed Christianity, there is very little faithfulness. There is very little devotion. There is very little loyalty. There is very little fidelity to God, if any at all. Men give great lip service to God, but when push comes to shove, they abandon God in a heartbeat.
You're right.
And it's time for God's people, for us, even our small group, to stand up and say, you either serve God and God only, or you don't serve Him at all.
Exactly.
Amen.
That's it.
This whole book is a book about the only true and living God and His Son.
Sir.
From beginning to end, it is this: who He would send, who He has sent, and who He is sending again.
Yeah. Amen.
That's what it's about. From beginning to end, who He would send, who He has sent, and who He is sending again.
Amen.
Pseudo-Christianity touts advancements. Supposed to be the proof of your fidelity to God. Not necessarily so. Go back and read Hebrews 11. By faith, some conquered kingdoms, wrought righteousness, subdued rather kingdoms, did they not? But others didn't accept deliverance.
Yeah.
Burned with fire, stoned to death, lived in caves.
Yes, sir.
Pseudo-Christianity touts advancements. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego touted their God.
Amen.
Pseudo-Christianity touts double portions. Go back and read the book of Job. You get to the last chapter of Job, and the last thing mentioned about Job is this. He basically got a double portion. He had twice as much as he had before. And religion says, woo, thank God.
Yeah.
Huh? That's not the point. Look at the first part of that chapter.
Exactly.
There's the point.
Yeah.
And Joe, you mentioned it. And I was glad you stayed away from my part of that, because this is what he said. I've heard of you with the hearing of my ear, but now my eye sees thee. Wherefore, I hate myself, and I repent in dust and ashes. There's the goal of everything that happened to Job. That's the whole goal.
Yes, sir.
He began that statement. His response back to God was this: I know that nothing, no thought of thine can be withholden from thee. He came to it by, I've heard of you. Heard the preacher preach. I'm putting it in our. I've heard the preacher preach. I believed what the preacher said. God's bound me to what the preacher said, the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. I've heard of you with the hearing in my ears, but then you experience the sovereign God.
Yes, sir.
And you say, but now mine eye sees you. Therefore, I hate myself and I repent of ever at any time I didn't hate myself before. So again I say, pseudo-Christianity touts double portions. Job touted his God.
Yes, sir.
Job 42, verses 1 through 6.
Amen.
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego praised God's authority. Mm-hmm. Right here in these, just this very short, brief, I mean, it wasn't, they said just, what is it, 15, 20, 30, 40 words. Next thing you know, they're being cast into the fiery furnace.
Exactly.
Yet Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego praised God's authority. It's not about how much you say, it's about what you say.
Yes, sir.
They praised God's authority. They praised God's will. Is that what so-called Christian religion does today? No, they're always talking about man's will.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And they exalt and tout man's will, and they put God's will down.
You're right.
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego praised God's will. They praised God's power. They praised God's ability. They praised God's sovereignty.
Yes, sir.
If it be so, but if not,
there you go.
Doesn't matter.
That's right. That's it.
He's sovereign. We bow to Him and Him only.
Amen.
Be careful about where you are, because where you are is designed by God to test what you claim you got in here. Where you're at out here is designed by God to test what you claim you got in here.
There you go.
Where does your loyalty lie? Where does your devotion lie? To what or whom are you faithful when the fire comes along? The glory of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's fidelity. And they had fidelity.
Yes, sir.
They were faithful. They were devoted. They were loyal. But the glory of their fidelity, yea, the glory of every believer's fidelity to God is based on the matchless majesty of our God, not on our fidelity.
That's right. Yeah.
The glory is in God, not in the fidelity. He's due the fidelity.
Yes, sir.
Isn't that the first commandment? The first commandment of what we call the Ten Commandments. That's the first one.
Yeah.
And Christ said that's the most important one. The second one's likened to it.
There you go.
Isn't that what He said?
Yes, sir.
They said, what's the most greatest commandment? He said, the first one's this. The second one's like unto it.
Yeah.
And He gave them. The very beauties of God, the very glory of God gives credence to every believer's fidelity, not vice versa.
There you go. Yeah.
Our fidelity doesn't give credence to God. If we deny Him, yet He remains faithful.
That's right. Amen.
Joe said it. He is light whether men see it or not. He is light whether men deny it or not. He is light. He is glory. He is majesty. He is sovereign. All those things.
Sir.
Let me give you five reasons or five statements here concerning this fact. The very beauties of God, the very glories of God give credence to every believer's fidelity, and not vice versa. Number one. Our refusal, any refusal of a believer to cower in shame and or fear at personal threats and insults toward our God. The glory of that is in our God, not in us.
That's right. Yes, sir.
That's the glory of it. Look at it. Shadrach, verse 16, Meshach and Abednego answered and said to the king, O King Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful. In other words, we don't have great care. We're going to answer you straight up. We put it in modern day language. We're going to put this right to you. They knew that their lives were in Nebuchadnezzar's hands. They didn't have the power nor the might to deliver themselves from his madness, did they?
That's right.
And what's the first thing they say? If it be so, we're going to be faithful. Huh? No. If it be so, here it is, our God.
Amen.
Before they ever said, whom we serve. Yes, they served Him.
Oh, yeah.
But what comes first? Our God.
There you go.
His beauty, His glory, His majesty, His authority, His will, His power, His ability, His sovereignty. That is the glory and the majesty of fidelity to God.
Yes, sir.
The Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 24, verse 15 said this, after the way they call heresy,
oh, yeah,
that's the way I worship the living God.
Amen.
Henry Mahan, I heard him say this years ago. Others have said it. He didn't come up with it, I don't figure, but he's the one I heard it from. And I thank God for it. He said this, you could have Baptists and a Methodist, a Presbyterian, a Church of God, and they disagree with one another. They'll argue about what each other believes.
Oh, yeah.
But you let one free, sovereign grace believer come into their midst and who is not careful to answer in a matter, who will speak up for the matter, and they'll all join together against that one individual.
Yes, sir, they will.
And that's just the way it happens. It's the way it is. Now, the reason we're not assaulted like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is, the reason is because lots of times we probably are too careful to answer, afraid to say something. I might lose a family member. So be it.
There you go.
I might lose a friend. So be it. I might lose a job. And I know some preachers can stand back and say that quite easily because they're getting their check every month from the church, and they tell everybody else, put God before your job. When their job is to put God first, Joe. That's quite easy. But I know what I'm talking about. Still yet, what is it? Fidelity, God is first before everything. I might lose my spouse. God is first.
Amen.
That's what fidelity is about. After the way they, who's the they? He's talking about his own kinfolk.
Yes, sir. He is. That's right.
And I don't know all that, but I think, you know, a mother, a father, a brother, a sister, a cousin,
yeah,
an aunt, an uncle. Could it not be, possibly? But he said, after the way they call heresy, that's the way I worship the living God. So our refusal to cower in shame, the glory is not of us. The glory is due God. Secondly, true fidelity bows to the sovereign purpose of God, if it be so.
Yeah.
And, but if not.
Exactly.
You see it? And if it be so, he'll deliver us.
Oh, yeah.
Why? Because he is able. The question, if it be so, is not concerning his ability, it's concerning his willingness.
That's right.
That's the question. If it be so, but if not, still doesn't matter. We will not bow to your gods.
Exactly.
We will serve him and him only. So true fidelity bows to the sovereign purpose of God. If it be so, but if not. You see, true fidelity is not presumptuous. True fidelity does not demand of God, it depends upon God.
Exactly.
As a matter of fact, even further, it believes God.
Amen.
But it believes God concerning his promise.
Yes.
Turn to Romans chapter 4 sometime and read it. That's what true, that's what unstaggering faith is. That's what true, strong, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. In what way? That what God had promised, God was able to perform. Now, had God promised Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you won't go into the fiery furnace? No. But they know this, God promised this, thou shalt worship me only.
That's right.
And there's blessing in that.
Exactly.
And they knew that's the course to take. Even if we faultingly do it, that's the course we take.
Yep.
Even if we can't attain unto it, Mason, as it ought to be attained unto, that's the course we take.
There
you go. Yes, sir. So again, I say true fidelity is not presumptuous. Well, God's got to get me out of this jam. No, he don't.
Right.
No, he don't. Unless he promised you specifically he'd get you out of that jam. All you can say is, if it be so, but if not.
There you go.
It still doesn't change anything. Do you see it? Still doesn't change anything. Number three, true fidelity acknowledges God's superiority over all other religion.
Yes.
Our God, whom we serve.
Yes, sir.
You see it?
There you go.
Not just any old God. Our God, whom we serve. In other words, let me put it in our modern day language and bring it home to us. As Don Fortner likes to say, put some shoe leather under it. True fidelity is not ecumenical.
That's right.
We're not trying to get along with everybody. These men not only were about to lose their jobs, they were about to lose their very life.
Yes, sir.
But they said, we're not careful to answer in this matter. We're going to serve God. We're going to serve God. How many of our brothers and sisters in time past, and maybe even some now in the present day, how many have been burned at the stake because they refused to bow down to other gods? Sadly, we're so far removed from that, we don't comprehend. We don't comprehend. And yet, folks, I'm no prophet, but if things continue on as they are, it may come back to that.
Amen.
It may come back to that. And you think losing your job is going to be the worst thing? Go read Fox's Book of Martyrs. They can do a lot of really bad stuff to us. Really bad stuff. So again, true fidelity is not ecumenical. Did not Paul say? And Paul didn't come up with this, because God had already said it in the Old Testament. Come ye out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord.
Amen.
God Almighty can't be joined up to an idol.
Right.
Unbelief cannot be joined up with belief. In particular, unbelievers cannot be joined up with believers.
That's right.
It just won't work. It won't work. Come ye out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and I will receive you. Is that what God says?
Yeah.
Well, that's Old Testament. No, that's repeated in the New Testament.
Yes, it is.
So much so, and I want to be sure I get it right. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, actually chapter 7. Look at it. Go back and read it some. Verse 7, come ye out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and I will be a father unto you, and ye shall be sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Having therefore these, what's that next word? Promises.
That's right.
So in other words, we have a reason to expect this.
Yes, sir.
If we by His grace are enabled to come out from among them, Mason, then we have His promise of what? That He will be a God unto us.
Yes, sir.
Do you see that? You will be my sons and my daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. The same one that delivered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego has given us this promise. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh. And everybody says amen to that. Quit you drinking, quit you smoking, quit you going to movies,
oh, yeah.
Unless it's Noah, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right. Wait a minute. What, flesh, what else though? That's true. Now, I'm making a little fun, but it says cleanse yourself of all filthiness of the flesh. But what else? And spirit. It's not just outward. It's inward as well.
Yeah, you go.
Perfecting. That means you got to work on it.
Yes,
it is a matter of struggle. And let me tell you, you think that wasn't difficult for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to do what they did? It was real.
Yes, sir.
Look, perfecting holiness. How? How? In the fear of God.
Amen.
So that's number three. True fidelity is not ecumenical. They tell us, well, you've got to respect all religions. Do you ever looked up what the word respect means?
Amen.
To give honor and praise and dignity to.
Yeah, that's right.
I cannot do that.
Exactly.
I cannot do that. God help me not to do that.
Amen.
Number four, true fidelity confesses God's absolute ability. Our God is able. You see it? He's able. The question is never, never His ability. The question is His will.
That's right.
You remember the leper? Matthew chapter 8, the leper who came running up to Christ. And you know what? The law said he wasn't supposed to do that.
That's right.
But Mason, he didn't do what the law said. And he came running up to Christ. And what did he say? Lord, if thou wilt,
amen,
thou canst make me clean. There's true fidelity. There's true faith. It wasn't a question of Christ's ability. It was a question of Christ's willingness to.
Amen.
And yet, those who profess to be Christians mock people like us for declaring that very truth. And they say, no, it all depends upon your will. Then God is able if you're willing. That's a false God.
Exactly.
You might as well erect Nebuchadnezzar's giant golden statue and bow down to it when they play Just As I Am.
Yeah, that's right.
Might as well. It's all still Babylon.
There you go.
It's all still error. Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst. And what did the Lord say to him? I like that. Think of it. I will. I will be thou clean. And you know what? Bless God, he was clean.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
All it took was the will of Christ.
Amen.
That man didn't even have to ask for it if Christ was willing.
Yeah, that's right.
But he made him willing to ask Christ and beg him, Lord, I know you can do it. I pray you're willing. But religion doesn't tell people to be like that today. They tell God's up there begging, just waiting. Oh, God's pleading. Bowed. It says he came and he worshiped him. That leper did. He worshiped him. So that's number four. True fidelity confesses God's absolute ability. Again, go back to Romans 4. What is strong faith? It is believing that what God has promised, God is able to perform.
Amen.
Number five, true fidelity remains faithful and willingly devoted even if death is the end of its reward. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O King. And God would one way or the other, even if death, that would have been deliverance out of his hand.
Yes, sir.
They wouldn't have had to suffer from the hand of Nebuchadnezzar Joe ever again.
That's right.
But look, but if not, be it known unto thee, O King, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. So true fidelity remains faithful and willingly devoted, even if death is the end of its reward. Turn back to Acts chapter 20. We have in Acts chapter 20 the account of the Apostle Paul meeting with the elders of Ephesus. And he actually met them at Miletus. He called for them. They came to Miletus to meet him. And this is what Paul said in verse 24. I'll just deal with this one part. But, look at verse 24, but none of these things move me. What kind of things? Even the threat of death. You see it?
That's right.
Go back and look at what it says. He said, bonds, the Holy Ghost has already witnessed bonds and afflictions. That's what I got in store. That's what's coming. That's not a maybe. The Holy Spirit done made this testimony. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself. Well, I might die doing this. Since God, I was going to, no, don't say if. Since God put me here, so be it.
Amen. There you go. Yeah.
What if it kills me? So be it. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. Even if it kills me preaching the gospel, that's what it'll be.
Yeah.
I will not back up.
That's right.
I will not bow down to anyone other than Jesus Christ. That's what it's all about. Now let me sum all of this up in these words. True fidelity to God finds its honor in God Himself, not in itself. Now did you hear what I said? I said true fidelity to God finds its honor in God Himself, not in itself. Paul didn't say, I'm going to do this because I'm so faithful. No, he just, I'm going to do this because there's something far more important than my comfort and even my life.
That's right.
Something far more important. What's that? The truth of the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now think about it. How much truth is the world in which we live? How much truth is the country in which we live? How much truth in the state in which we live? How much truth in the community in which you live? How much truth are they getting? How much? I say apart from a few handfuls here and there, they're getting none. They're getting none. But God's ordained that those few handfuls are the ones that are sent out to gather in the other handfuls, Mason.
Yeah.
That's how it works. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. This is what we ought to do with everything we are. Everything we should be concerned about is what? The gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because it's the only truth. Listen, it's the only truth that will ever save a man's soul. The law is true, but it won't save you. Righteousness, personal right, being right, doing right, living right, that's true, but it won't save you. Morality is a lie. Morality is a lie.
There you go.
Ain't none of us moral.
There you go.
Any more than any of us righteous in that matter. The only truth that benefits the soul of man is the truth of the person and work of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And may it be that we hear. Hey, here's how important it is. You remember John the Baptist?
Oh, yeah.
Those Pharisees came to his baptism? He said, "You bunch of snakes."
That's right.
That's the way you win folks over, ain't it?
There you go.
He said, "You bunch of snakes, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come?" Now, he said, "Let me tell you something. You show me you mean business first, then I'll baptize you, but not until." And that what he said?
Yes,
tell them.
Sir.
Bring forth works meet for repentance. But you know what? Don't think within yourself to say, "We got Abraham to my father." Oh, I believe this, or I got that. He said, God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham.
Amen.
See, God will get it done.
Yes.
But he will get it done because he raises up somebody to say what they're supposed to say, to do what they're supposed to do,
right,
to be where they're supposed to be.
Yeah.
If it ain't me, it'll be somebody else.
That's it.
But you know what I want? I want to be a part of that group.
Yes, sir.
Don't you? I want to be a part of that group that has to say through the restraint and the constraint of the love of Christ, if it be so. But if not, I will serve no one else other than Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Father, not only teach us these things, but make them a reality in our hearts and minds and souls. And may it truly be a reality based upon the glories of the person and work of our matchless, glorious Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, give us devotion to Him, fidelity to Him, by Your grace. Amen.